our second presentation will be from Yingjin Yuan from Tianjin University. And he'll be sharing with us today research on program bacterial symbiosis.
Thanks, Chair, for the introduction. I'm Yingjin Yuan from Tianjin University. This talk will cover the background information, design, and construction of the symbiosis, and the modeling and simulation, and the experimental result compared with the simulation. I would like to give you some background information first. As you know, in industry biotechnology areas, microbial symbiosis becomes more and more important in the production of food and beverage, medicine, bioenergy, and wastewater treatment. Following, I will Following, I will give you one example for the production of medicine. As you know, in China, vitamin, about 60% of vitamin C produced in China in 2008, according to a report in WHAT. And the bioprocess for the vitamin C has been widely concerned in China. For this process, it is produced in an airlift bioreactor. There are four phases. First, the two organisms incubated simultaneously. There is a larger bacteria and there are the smaller ones. They simultaneously inoculated into the airlift bioreactor at the initial stage. Then go to the second stage. The big stream began to grow, and during the exponential growth, they exist as a tropism sum. And while the oxygen, the small organism was still in the lag phase, like this. This is the growth curve for the small stream, and this for the large stream. At the third stage, the big streams appear as monomers after the traffic broke down and became the endospores. And meanwhile, the small streams began to grow, like this one, and the vitamin C produced and gradually become large enough. At this fermentation process, the big streams first grow exponentially and produce metabolites that stimulate the small stream to produce vitamin C. And at the final stage, the big streams enter the decaying phase, and the small one grows steadily, and the vitamin reaches the maximum level. There is a good example to show in industry production of vitamin C. It is a valid application in China's vitamin industry process. From this example, you can see for the natural macro biosense community, very complex in nature, and it's very hard for us to engineer in lab conditions. And there are also some examples in nature, like terminate gut. And this is very precise example. Several streams work together and produce a lot of beneficial products. But it is a, But it is unclarified since mechanism, and it is least to be transferred to industry applications. So there's a great need to uncover the mechanism and the complex interactions within the natural microbial systems. And due to some problem like quantitative measurement of the environmental factors and the things and behavior obviously often fails because of the entangled intrinsic parameters and unmeasurable population dynamics. So recent years, the emerging synthetic biology helps us to construct an artificial ecosystem with a clear genetic background to simplify the interactions between the symbiosis and the more possible to know properties. So for this, there are three works will be mentioned. One is published in PNAS by Shong, the synthetic correlation in engineering yeast. Another example is Weber published in PNAS about the work synthetic ecosystem based on the airborne inter and intra kingdom communication. And this year, Bagarda have published a paper in molecular synthesis biology about the synthetic E. coli predator and prey ecosystems. And this example shown that the synthetic biology has been successfully applied in constructing simplified artificial ecosystems, which shown similarity with the nature counterpart like cooperation, symbiosis, prey and predator. However, the influence of environmental factors on the synthetic population is still not to be well concerned. So this work will design and construct two strains of E. coli cell, which could form various biological relationships along with the fluctuation of antibiotics as the environmental process. Following, I would like to introduce our engineered E. coli. We engineered two E. coli cells, one of them called ER, another we called EJ. For the EJ, penicillin can inhibit this cell, and carbamazepine can inhibit the ER cell. And this is, we use two non-interferon chromatin sensing system. One is a LUX-I and a LUX-R system. Another is a RHI and RHI systems. So we need initial concentration density for these two cells because they we can activate the cells by the AHI or BHI cell single molecules. So after the concentration reaches high enough, so LUX-I can produce sufficiently AHR cell and binding to LUX-R and activate the PLUX and facilitate the expression of AMP, so can use resistant to ampicillin. And for the ER cell, the BHR can bind to HR and activate PRH gene and facilitate the expression of PIN. So this cell can resist to the carbamazepine in mediums. So this cell can be detected by the red fluorescent protein and and this can be detected by the green fluorescent proteins. Initially, in the ER cell, we have a melanin resistant gene, encoding the engineered with the RPF. And in the EJ cell, there is initially carbamazepine engineered genes, resistant genes in this cell. So we need an initial concentration, higher enough concentration of the cell, so they can produce enough higher concentration of AHI or BHI, can two strains can collaborate together. Following, I would like to introduce our modeling and simulation work. We have the following assumption: the growth of the cell following the logistic kinetics and the nutrition competition is included. The inhibition of antibiotics to the cell growth is proportional to the antibiotics concentration, and the degradation of the antibiotics by the decomposing enzyme is a typical enzymatic process following macro and maintenance equations, and the mechanism of chromosensing following here equation dynamics. Following gives the ordinary differential equations, like for the red cell and for the green cell, this is the growth kinetics, and for the compact consumption of both antibiotics like penicillin and canicillin, and this shown the consumption of this is shown the bonding kinetics of AHL and BHL, like this two equation, and for the both resistant gene, the expression kinetics can be using these two equations. So by solving this set of equations, we get some simulation result. This shown there is no antibiotic adding, so the growth of the ER and the EJ following this curve, and for both ER and the EJ following this curve. When there is antibiotic adding to the symptoms, the growth later than the previous ones. So this, this shows at a fixed concentration of amylase and canalicin, the cells of ER, EJ, and both ER and EJ can grow in this way. And this diagram shown us as the concentration of the antibody increase, the minimum of the initial population density required for the population survival will rise up dramatically. And this diagram shows a phase diagram about the cell to cell relationship among the immune factor, camelicin, and ampelicins. They can be divided into five zones. In zone one, any kind of cell can be survived. This we call extinction in zone one, and zone two, we call it obligatory mutualism, because in this the zone two, only two cells can survive together. Any of the cell cannot be survived in zone two, and in zone three and zone five. In zone three, EJ cell can grow independently, but the ER can only be survived in the existence of EJ. Similarly, in zone 5, the ER cell can grow independently, and the EJ can only be survived in the existence of ER. So we call it a chameleon. And for the zone 4, we call it a non-obligatory symbiosis. Because the concentration of the both antibiotics the lower enough, so the two strains can independently grow, and if they co-cultured, they build some competitions to the neutrons. So this is the simulation of the phase diagram. Following, I give you some our experimental result. And this shows the EJ cell individually. The cell receives the AHL signal molecule and express the penicillin resistant proteins. So for the EJ cell, when there is no penicillin and no single molecules, this blue lines, blue curve, shows the growth curves. And if we add penicillin to the EJ cell and no single molecules, then the cell cannot grow. And if we add the antibody and simultaneously add the AHL single molecule, then the cell can also grow like this. This shown as the expression of the green fluency proteins. The trees are very similar, but this shows the ER cells, the similarly with the primary one. The ER cell receive BHR signal molecule and express kinase resist proteins. The results are very similar with the primary one. And these two figures showing us for the control one, two cells concur together and the fluency changes like this. When there are both the antibody adding to the symptoms, the growth like this. So the preliminary result shown that ER over virus EG in population at the existence of antibodies. And when we reveal the simulation result, we can see the fitness of the experimental result is pretty well with the simulation result. We can see this because the antibodies, there are some also changes during the process, during the culture process. Both amylase and kanamycin decrease with the increase of population densities due to the gradual decomposition of the antibodies. This is the curve showing the decomposition of the antibodies. This shows the penicillin and the red line shows the kanamycin. This is detected by the RC mass. And we also, from the time scale, we can see it decreased very quickly to a very low level at the before the exponential phase. Let's back to this figure. We can see before 11 o'clock, there's almost no fluency can be detected at the influence of antibodies. So, then when the body adding to the concurrent symptoms, they decrease very fast. And these three pictures shows the influence of different niche population densities. When the population density increased, we can see it can enhance the symptom resistance to the antibodies. This is the phase diagram about the cell densities with the amylase and kinase. When the initial population density increase, then it can enhance the symptoms and resistance to antibiotics. And this shown when the antibody concentration increase and the resistance and the initial EG and ER population density should be increased. This is very similar with considered with the result of the simulation like this. This curve considered with the experimental result very well. And this shows the influence of antibodies on population density. And this phase diagram I have introduced. This is by simulation result. Like we look at this figure. There's only EG cells exist, and only in this region the cell can exist. And the, for the ER cell, only in this region cell can survive well. And for the culture of the two strains, we can see the different zone. For example, we take zone one as an example. So you can see the 3 points. In zone one, any individual ER or EG cannot survive. Even for cone culture of E, R, and J cannot survive. That means in the zone of one, it is in the exist, in the state of extinction. In the zone five, you can see this is the EJ cell and this is the ER cell. EJ cell cannot survive, ER cell can survive, and when cone culture together, both cells can have survive well. So we call it a combination symptoms. And we take this red in zone two as another example. We can see the three, for the individual EJ cells, they cannot survive, and for the ER, they also cannot survive. But when both strains cone culture together, they can survive very well. So we, from this four figures, we can see our experimental result fit the simulation result very well. So from the following introduction, we can conclude we design and construct a synthetic thin biases with the corresponding environmental effect. And different population of dynamic cooler form, forms depending on different level antibody concentration. In our research, five zones can be formed. The resistance of the ecosystem stability increases with the rise of initial population density. So if we want to increase the resistance of the system stability, we should increase the initial population density. And a dominant space could form due to the interaction of environmental pressure and population diversity. We would like the Science Foundation of China and Ministry of Science Technology for providing our money. And all of the our the BioBrick provided the BioBrick foundations. And the graduate student and the undergraduate student take part in the research work. We also thank the student for the research work. Thank you very much.
All right, we have time for questions for the speaker. I'll start off with a question. Do you have, this was done with strains of E. coli, right? And so are there particular, now that you've sort of set up these two strains that can, whether you sort of tune their dependence on each other for growth, are there particular pathways or processes that you're actually looking at, thinking to sort of extend and put into these cells that might benefit from having two different specialized strains for production of different chemicals or materials?
Up to now, we haven't detected the specific pathways. The initial design ideas is about we insert two resistant genes into two cells. So one cell can resist to amylopectin and another can resist to commandant. So,
okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Up here.
Back there, yes.
So I was wondering, did you look at the stability of this system over time, that maybe there would be a strong pressure on the system that, for instance, whatever the resistance from one strain goes off to the other one? Did you sequence those things after several generations or make selection experiments or things like that?
You mean the sequence of
Of the plasmids, that maybe there's an exchange of material between the strains after a while, because I would imagine that this kind of system, there's a strong pressure that one strain gets both resistances to survive alone.
The copy number is different. So so the the EJ, because the copy number is different.
There's a question over there.
Have you characterized the crosstalk between these two systems? So, for example, there's some versions of RHEL-R and the RHEL promoter that are activated by 3OC6 HSL, and how would that affect it?
Mm-hmm. Sorry, would you...
Have you measured the crosstalk? So, for example, there's some versions of the RHEL-R and the RHEL promoter that are actually activated by 3OC6 HSL, which is produced by your LuxEye.
We detected the AHL and the BHL, and meanwhile, we detect, but I'll say mass detected the amylase and penicillin. Only these four molecular, smaller molecular were detected during the process. But the we also detected using the gels.
Yeah. Maybe, so LuxEye
yeah.
produces 3OC6 HSL.
Mm-hmm.
Which in for certain combinations of the RHEL-R and the RHEL promoter that you're using
mm-hmm.
may actually activate it. So you may have some self-activation of ER.
Mm-hmm.
Is this something that you looked at? Is that something you measured?
Actually, we haven't monitored all of the parameters.
Was there one other question over there? No. Any left? We have time for one more question if there are any. Okay, let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you.